egitarauari aurre eginez, besterik gabe, nik sarrera emango diot eta hitza emango diot Euskal Ikaskuntzako lehendakariari Iñaki Dorronsorori.
Jaun andreok, egunon denori, pixka bat azkar abiatzeko eta ekitaldeari hasiera emateko, hitzo batzue bakarrik irekurriko dizuet. Eusko Ikaskuntza, 1918an, lau foru aldundiek sustatuta sortu zen erakundea da. Aintzindarietako bat Nafarroako euskaltzale talde bat izan zen. Horregatik lehen batzorde eragileko ohorezko lehendakaria Arturo Kanpion izendatu zuten. Gure ohitura zaharrarekin jarraituz, Nafarroako eta Iparraldeko bazkide eta laguntzaileak ere gomidatu ditugu ekitaldi honetara. Aintzindariek Eusko Ikaskuntza unibertsitate saiakera bat bezala sortu zuten. Bere kultura arte aztertuz, herrialde Basko-Nafarroak deitzen zioten herri baten kezka, ardura eta erronka zuzentzeko asmoarekin. Beti herriak ezinbestekotzat jotzen zituen beharretara bideratu zuten bere ahalegin guztia. Joan zen 2013 urtean, gure jarduera zientifiko, hausnarketa eta divulgazio lanak euskal gizartearen ezagutza garapenera bideratzea erabaki genuen. Ezagutza sailkatzetik problematizazio orokorretara hurbilduz. Azken finean, Baskoniaren etorkizuneko ikuspegi eraberritu bat garatzeko eta gaur egungo erronkei aurre egiten lagunduz, irtenbide ausart eta kementsuak proposatu eta sustatzeko. Eta zeregin horretan, Euskal Herriko erakunde, unibertsitateak bereziki, eragile eta gizarte zibilaren arteko zubilan eta elkarlana bultzatuz eta baliatuz. Egun, bost eremu nagusi lantzen ditu Eusko Ikaskuntzak. Bat, eredu sozioekonomikoa eta esperientzia berriak. Bi, Euskal Herriaren egiturak eta soziopolitikoa eta eremu hontan kokatzen da gaurko ekitaldia. Hiru, Euskal kultura eta Euskal gizartearen kultura aldaketa. Lau, Euskararen etorkizuna. Eta bost, prospektiba eta estenatokia osnarketaren bitartez Euskal Herriaren etorkizuna. Idoia Estornesek bere historian garbi esaten digu 1918ko hasierako giro hartan Eusko Ikaskuntza autonomiaren abiatze saiakera bat bezala sortu zela. Gaurko giroak berriz garbi agertzen digu estatu antolaketa, nazio eta demokraziaren inguruko teoria eta esperientziek tratamendu eraberrituak eskatzen ari zaizkigula. Baina zer tratamendu? Gogora dezagun, iritzi edo erabaki bat hartzerakoan, hiru galdera erantzun behar zirela esaten zuen Greziako jakintxu hura. Lehenengo, egia da ala ez da. Bigarren, zuzena da, justua da. Hirugarren, ederra da. Zientzia, etika eta estetika. Hiru eremu ezberdin eta hiruren artean edo gainetik politika. Asko dira gaia hoi etikaren eremutik eratzuten saiatzen ari direnak, eta askoz gehiago kontzeptu hauek eremu politikotik tratatzen ari direnak ere. Pentsatzen dut, lehenengo galderaren erantzuna gehien bat zientziaren eremuari dagokiola, eta hori dela Eusko Ikaskuntza eta hemen bildu garen unibertsitateen zeregina. Baina hasiera-hasieratik onartu beharrean nago, egia den ala ez argitze hori, ad infinitum prozesu baten bukaera ideal bat besterik ez dela. Gogoratuko ditut, George Simmel soziologo eta pensalari alemaniar handiaren izauek. El conocimiento puede tener una base absoluta en algún lugar, sin embargo, donde está ese lugar no lo podemos determinar irrevocablemente, y a fin de no llevar el pensamiento a un dogma o ideología, habremos de tratar el punto alcanzado siempre como si fuera el penúltimo. Todo nuestro saber es una obra imperfecta y ninguna de sus partes es incorregible, lo cual se encuentra en una relación extraña y defectuosa con su aparente carácter indiscutible. Errealitatearen ezaugarri ugaritasun eta aldakortasunak gainditu egiten gaitu beti. Gure ulermenerako ahalegin guztiak kontradiziorako faktorez josiaz. Eta Simelek honela jarraitzen du. Y son precisamente las abstracciones últimas y más elevadas, las simplificaciones y resúmenes del pensamiento, las que deben renunciar a la aspiración dogmática de acotar el conocimiento. Heráclito que esan zuen, inor ezin da bi aldiz murgildu erreka berberean. Ez da ikerlari bat gizon eta emakumeen bizitzaren edo gizartearen evoluzioaren ibaietan ere. Ez da laborategi baten baldintza guztia kontrolpean direlarik esperimentuak errepikatu ere. Baina egun, badirudi, batzuentzat behintzat, estatua, nazioa eta demokrazia bezalako goreneko astrazio horien errealitateren inguruan ezagutza eta ulermen prozesuak amaituak direla. Azkeneko egia absolutuetara iritsi garela. Beraz, jardunaldi hauek teoria eta filosofia politiko ezberdinen arteko eztabaidaren ordez, hainbat kasu aztertu eta konparatuz, ezagutzaren prozesua jarraitzeko eta ezagutza hori gizarteratzeko nahiarekin antolatzen ditugu. Errealitateen anistasun aberasgarri horrekin, bat datozen ulermen prozesuak sustatu ahal izateko. Beste zeregin garrantzitsu bat ere badugu eskuartean. Zientzia disiplina arteko begirada bultzatzea eta lehen aipatutako eremu horien arteko solasaldi esparruak ere lantzea. Gaurko jardunaldia gure ideologia politikoak eta Europako estatu antolakuntza kasu ezberdin hauen arteko ikaskuntza saiakera bezala ere antolatu nahi izan ditugu. Dazotzen ordu tinko hauek mamitsuak izango zaitzuelakoan, eskerrak eman nahi dizuet hemen hurbildu zeteten guztioi.
Egunon, buenos días, good morning, bonjour. Ongi etorriak izan zaitezte guztiok ekitaldi honetara, Gasteizera. Bienvenidos, bienvenidas, welcome. Milesker, gaurkoan gurekin izatiarren, plazer handia da, benetan olako ekitaldi baten parte hartzia, eta batez ere, ba, goizian ziar izango ditugun ponenteak entzuteko aukera izati, ezta? Beraz, nire lehen hitzak eskerronekuak, eskerrak Eusko Ikaskuntzari eta eskerrak Eusko Jaurlaritzari ba, horrelako ekitaldiak prestatzeko sustatziarren, eta nola ez, mila esker, ba, goizian zehar hitz egingo duten sei islariei. Thank you very much, merci beaucoup. Nos aguarda por delante una mañana intensa, seguro, muy interesante, y me atrevo a decir que a todas luces corta para el objetivo último de estas jornadas, que no es otro que escuchar y aprender, nada más y nada menos. Pero siendo conscientes de ello, siendo conscientes de la limitación temporal, el ejercicio que vamos a realizar es muy concreto, ¿no? Desde este momento y hasta las dos, no pretende ser más que un punto de partida, un punto de arranque de un proceso más a medio-largo plazo, un proceso de reflexión sobre el autogobierno, sobre los diferentes estatus. Por lo tanto, un punto de arranque, esa reflexión nace hoy, parte hoy y no tiene que acabar con la jornada de hoy. Eta nola egingo dugu hori, ze proposamen, nola ekingo diogu autogobernuari buruzko hausnarketa horri. Ba, gure proposamena zera da, kanpora begiratzea. Osa, gure begirada norberaren zilborretik anpiskat aratago eruan, eta atzerrira behatzea. Beste gabe, besteen esperientziak entzun, aditu, beste realitateak ezagutu, beste ereduak ikusi, alderatu euren artean, alba da euskal kasuarekin. Helburu ez da inolaz ere ez beste lekuetako ereduak gurien aplikatzia, hori ezinezkoa da. Hau da, baldintza ezberdina dira, oroar testu ingurua ezberdina da, orduan helburu ezin da izan estrapolatzia, hori ezinezkoa dalako. Baina agian, hori kontutan izan da, agian bai aldegula, ba elementu batzuk hartu edo, erreferentzi batzuk edo, formula batzuk edo, mekanismo batzuk ezagutu, eta gero ikusi, ia aplikagarria dian edo baliagarria dian gure ereduarentzat. Por tanto, la propuesta de esta mañana es escuchar. Escuchar y aprender y comparar y siendo muy práctica como soy yo, incluso tomar apuntes, ¿no? Tomar nota de todo aquello que consideremos interesante, que nos pueda ayudar a entender nuestra propia realidad. Los cuatro ponentes que participarán en la primera tanda de la mañana nos mostrarán diferentes casos, la heterogeneidad dentro de Europa, diferentes maneras de entender la distribución territorial del poder político. Son Drew Scott, David Krikemans, Nicholas Schmidt y Philip Steele. Nos hablarán sobre los casos de Escocia, Flandes, Suiza y Baviera, respectivamente. Yo creo que será muy interesante ver qué de innovador nos puede ofrecer cada uno de ellos, cada modelo, principalmente desde el punto de vista conceptual. ¿Por qué? Bueno, por un lado, porque creo que posiblemente esta mañana se utilicen aquí conceptos que nosotros conocemos, pero que quizá los entendamos de forma distinta, le demos un contenido distinto. Y por otra parte, quizá surjan también conceptos nuevos. Entonces, yo creo que esa comparativa, analizar esto puede ser muy, muy, muy revelador. ¿El mecanismo cuál va a ser? Pues tras las cuatro ponencias primeras tendremos unos 30 minutos en los que plantearé a poder ser un par de preguntas a cada ponente. A todos los ponentes les rogaría que se ajusten al tiempo para que podamos hablar todos y participar. Después tendremos un descanso, un café. A partir de las 12 en la segunda tanda, Patricia Popelía y José Ramón Bengoechea nos mostrarán ¿qué lectura se hace en la Unión Europea de esa riqueza, de esa heterogeneidad? Si la UE abraza esa diversidad como elemento altamente positivo para seguir avanzando, o si por el contrario lo ven como, si no un problema, como un escollo, quizá. Y al final de la mañana tendremos otro tiempo de debate en el que ustedes podrán formular sus preguntas a mano alzada. Os ruego que las preguntas sean muy concretas, concretas, concisas, claras, breves, se señale también a quién van dirigidas y luego en las carpetas que les han repartido tienen unas tarjetas, en las carpetas ahí encontrarán unas tarjetas en las que pueden formular las preguntas que no den tiempo a formular aquí o, por el contrario, si no quieren hacerlo de viva voz y están habilitadas algunas urnas, algunas cajas ahí para que puedan depositarlas a la salida. Y la organización se compromete a responder a todas esas preguntas. Estas jornadas se pueden seguir por streaming y en la página web de Eusko Ikaskuntza se podrá acceder a la grabación de las mismas. Y asimismo se colgará en la web el documento con todas esas respuestas a las preguntas que ustedes formulen y a todos los asistentes, y también las conclusiones que extraigamos al final de la jornada y a todos los asistentes se les enviará un mensaje con el acceso directo a dicho documento. Bueno, y sin más, voy a dar la palabra al primer ponente, a Drew Scott. Drew Scott, Edimburgoko Unibertsitatean Europar Batasunaren inguruko ikasketetako irakasle da. Formazioz ekonomista. Urte askotan ibili da Scott, Erresuma Batuko eta Eskoziaren egoerari buruzko ikerketak zuzentzen. Alaber, ikertzen aritu da baita ere Europar Batasuneko auzi ekonomiko eta gobernantzaren inguruan, ala nola honelako gaietan, subsidiarietatea, batasun ekonomiko eta monetarioa eta erregioen rola Europar Batasuneko prozesu legislatiboan eta sorkuntza politikoan. 2012 eta 2004 bitxartian, Scott irakaslea gobernu eskoziarraean ibili da aholkulari, Eskoziako independentziak izango lituzkeen ondorietan aditu bezala. Sin más, la palabra es suya, profesor Scott.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here. I always feel it's very interesting to come to the Basque Country because for many of us who have examined the Scottish situation and devolution in the UK. The Basque Country has been a model which we have tended to refer to very often. Sorry, there's some technical issues.
It's okay.
Okay, we got it. That's great, thank you. It's particularly a pleasure to be here, and I'd like to thank the organisers very much for the invitation. What I'd like to do in my 20 minutes, and I'm going to start my stopwatch to ease the burden on the chair, is really just to discuss some of the issues which have unfolded in the UK, because over the period since 1998 to the present, the UK has gone from being arguably the most centralised state in the European Union to one of the most decentralised. And I want to just give a brief review of that before looking at more substantive questions revolving around the current situation. So there's four points I'd like to discuss in the course of this intervention, and they're on the screen. So let me begin looking briefly at what happened after 1998, when legislation was enacted in the UK Parliament that devolved powers to what we call the devolved administrations. Those are administrations, of course, in Wales, Northern Ireland, and of course Scotland. I think there's a significant difference between polities where powers are devolved downwards from a centralised government versus the more traditional federal system, when powers are transferred upwards to the central state. And I think sometimes we assume these are symmetric processes, and I think certainly the evidence we have in the UK is that they're far from symmetric processes. Devolution itself was asymmetric. That is to say, the devolution granted to the Scottish government...
I beg your pardon. The Scottish government... Is that better now? Getting a bit of feedback on it. The devolution granted to the Scottish Parliament was legislative devolution. The devolution granted at the time to the Welsh and Northern Irish assemblies was administrative, much less so than legislative, although in Wales that is changing. Is that feedback problematic? No, I think it's... No, I'm not sure why it's... Is that... Let me put that off. Okay, that's better. Sorry, that was quite disconcerting. Under the 1998 legislation, what was not reserved to the UK government, the UK Parliament was devolved. The key issues that were reserved to the central state, to the UK state, of course, were the constitution, defence, taxation, welfare, and of course foreign affairs. They were the main issues that were reserved. What wasn't reserved was actually devolved. So the Scottish Parliament became competent to legislate across a wide range of policy areas, including justice, because Scotland is a separate legal jurisdiction from the rest of the UK, justice, economic development, health, education, universities, and so on. So there was a significant tranche of powers devolved to the Scottish Parliament under the 1998 legislation. The key problem with that legislation was that the financing of the Scottish Parliament remained very much in the hands of the UK government. In other words, devolution was financed, the spending on those policies was financed by a block grant. And that led to a number of issues, which I'm sure many here are familiar with. Block grants tend to be quite inefficient ways of financing devolved spending or spending by subnational governments, because of course there's no relationship between spending and taxation, which means that the devolved government will spend what it receives, regardless of whether the spending is economically or socially efficient. It will simply spend it. And of course, because it's not having to raise the money directly by its own taxes, that encourages it to be profligate, and encourages it just simply to spend whatever it can. And that is widely regarded as being inefficient, both politically, because the lines of accountability between the electorate and the government are not complete, and of course economically, because you may be spending in areas where the returns are not significant or indeed could be negative. So the block grants and the Barnett formula, and I'm not going to detain you with the Barnett formula because it's people have died worrying about the Barnett formula. We can come back to how the money is financed in due course if you wish. At the centre of the Scotland legislation was an agreement that there would be intergovernmental relationships forged between the new Scottish government and the UK government. Now, the UK, as most of you will know, does not have a constitution as such. Sovereignty, the Westminster Parliament, truly is sovereign in the sense there is no external court, with the exception of the European Court of Justice and, to an extent, the European Court of Human Rights, but there is no domestic constitutional court that places a limit on the powers of the UK Parliament. So, because the UK Parliament is sovereign and remained sovereign after devolution, because the UK Parliament conceivably could pass an act to dissolve the Scottish Parliament, because it was sovereign, we had to have relations between the Scottish and the UK Parliaments. And they were forged by a series of memorandums and what were called concordats. These are just understandings based on trust, and they've worked fairly well, but they are not legal documents. So the dialogue between Edinburgh and London was rich, it was regular, but ultimately, the UK government retained sovereignty. There was an agreement that the UK government would desist from legislating in any area that was devolved to Scotland. They would not legislate for Scotland. That was called the Sewell Convention. And in the last Scotland Act, which has just been enacted, 2016, that has now been confirmed as to be the case, that the UK government will not legislate for Scotland over matters which are devolved. But technically they could, because the UK Parliament is sovereign. So this is an interesting constitutional muddle in the UK, and I'm happy to pick up some of the implications of that, not least on the European side in due course. So the Parliament convenes in 1999, and it's a proportional elected Parliament, so a majority government is not expected to emerge, and is expected the Scottish National Party, which of course is the Independence Party of Scotland, would be an opposition party in this kind of configuration. In 2007, the Scottish National Party won the Scottish Parliament elections and formed a minority government. A very courageous move to form a minority government, and that worked relatively successful till 2011. Then in May 2011, we had this astonishing result in the Scottish politics, whereby the Scottish National Party won an absolute majority of the seats in the Scottish Parliament. That was extraordinary for a number of reasons, not least politically, simply the system was not supposed to allow that. But it also reflected a transformation in the nature of Scottish politics away from traditional voting patterns, which of course in Scotland, since time began, had been for the Labour Party, the traditional Socialist Party. Now the Scottish National Party had emerged as a social democratic party, a civic party, not an ethnic party, a civic party, and it became the dominant force in Scottish politics. In response to the rise of the SNP as early as 2007, the Unionist parties, and I use that term to gather together the Labour Party, the Conservative Party, and the Liberal Democrat Party in Scotland, they had decided to mount a kind of response to the rise of the SNP to try and give Scotland more powers. And that became, I call it devolution 2.0. That is, the Calman Commission proposed new powers, particularly increased powers over taxation, should come to the Scottish Parliament. In many views, that was too little too late, and the dynamic of the SNP continued to grow. We then come to the most extraordinary period in Scottish politics, certainly in my lifetime, and I suspect in most people's lifetime in Scotland, which was the independence referendum, such that in October 2012, when the SNP won a majority in the Scottish Parliament, a referendum was inevitable, okay? In every manifesto the SNP had produced, they had called for a referendum on independence. So when they won, astonishingly, they won a majority, which was a surprise to them as much as anybody, they had no choice. It was, in a sense, a political force majeure. They had to have a referendum on independence. And in October 2012, an agreement was signed between the Scottish and UK governments that would temporarily transfer sovereignty over the constitution to the Scottish government. That allowed the Scottish Government to call, to finance and to manage a referendum. The conditions that the UK government placed on that referendum were twofold. It must happen before the end of 2014, and it must be a single yes-no question. There can't be a third option, a devil max option, as we talk about. There cannot be a third option. So between October 2012 and the referendum date in September 2014, we found the campaign began. And it was a fascinating campaign. As the chair said, I spent the whole campaign inside the Scottish Government because my interest was European policy. And we'd had some rather unfortunate, in my view, and in some people's views who are better placed legally than me, illegal, comments by the President of the European Commission, José Manuel Barroso, who had implied, and I know that José Ramón's going to pick this up later on today, who had implied that should Scotland vote for independence, then she would have to leave the European Union. So my job for 2 years was really unpicking that and developing a strategy around that particular problem, which personally I still do not believe would have happened. But that's a different story. So what we had between 2012 and 2014 was this extraordinary campaign, extraordinary in so many different ways. First of all, we included 16 and 17-year-olds in the electoral mandate so they could vote for the first time in Scottish politics, for the first time in British politics. And I can promise you that our current First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, who was Deputy First Minister during the campaign, will tell you, quite frankly, the most terrifying moment in her campaign was when she was confronted with 3,000 16 and 17-year-olds. They asked the questions that were impolite, that were direct, and were incredibly astute politically, albeit there were 16 and 17-year-olds. And that really energized the campaign in a way that no political campaign had been energized before. A second thing that was fascinating about it were the papers produced by both sides. The Scottish Government produced papers on the benefits and implications of independence. They were very upbeat. The question was, do you want to be an independent country? To which the answer was yes, as far as the Scottish Government is concerned. And the lesson we learned from that referendum was that when one of the answers is yes, that's the side you want to be on. Because that's a very uplifting answer. No is a very negative answer. And actually, the Better Together Union campaign suffered because it was a no campaign. Now, what we've seen in the current UK-Europe referendum is a question about remain or leave. That's quite deliberately been designed in the shadow of the Scottish campaign, where the no side had a very, very difficult fight. And it became a very negative campaign, very negative campaign. The Scottish Government's main shot was a white paper which set out its view of an independent Scotland, a very aspirational paper, incredibly well written in my view, setting out the opportunities that would come to Scotland if the Scottish Government had competences over the entire range of economic and welfare policies. And this was a referendum fought on the economy. It wasn't fought on culture. Culture was there. It wasn't fought on welfare. Welfare was there. It was actually fought on the economy. And that was the biggest mistake in some ways, because the economy from 2008 was tanking. It was a very difficult economic environment. And I think that made winning a referendum in that economic context, when the economy was front and center of the debate, very, very difficult. But the white paper predicated on what I called a soft exit. In other words, Scotland would become independent within a consensus process after which the governments of the UK and Scotland would work together in the best interests of both populations. There would be a common shared interest in making this work easily, in minimising the disruption. That was the second profound error that the SNP made. They believed a soft exit was possible. Certainly, from an economic perspective, it's desirable, because if you don't work together in a coordinated way, you will make mistakes. But politically, of course, a soft exit was reducing the costs of separatism as far as the UK were concerned. So they came in with a very hard exit strategy. That was a surprise, particularly over the currency. So we had this difference between the soft exit strategy of the Scottish Government in the White Paper and the hard exit strategy of the UK. That was represented in 15 highly technical Treasury papers that appeared over the course of 18 months. And as you can imagine, these papers were incredibly well written, very well argued, if sometimes, in my view, exaggerating the difficulties or just being plain wrong. I mean, one of the examples where they were plain wrong, in my view, was the Eurozone crisis. Again, that was used to demonstrate why a single currency arrangement wouldn't work. Well, the Eurozone tells us many things about single currency arrangements, but two countries who have more or less same productivity, same standard of living, same rate of economic growth, same structure of economy, they can live within a single currency area. So then the key debates were the currency, as I've said, Scottish Government's view, we share the pound, we retain the currency, that retains the internal market of the UK, particularly important for financial services, very strong economic sector in Scotland. European Union, big debate over the European Union, the UK government assuring us that Scotland would be evicted from the EU, and it was quite clear at the time that no government was prepared to talk to the Scottish government because the UK had said, we believe that you shouldn't talk to the Scottish government, and they will be evicted from the EU in the event of independence, and that would be very disruptive. True or false, it would be very disruptive if it was true. And the final area of contention was fiscal policy and public spending. Could Scotland afford to be independent? Now, you can imagine the impact of the oil price collapse immediately after the referendum, and there's a lot of concern, had Scotland become independent, which would have been about now, according to the 18-month timetable the former First Minister had defined, then yes, it would have been a tough position to be in fiscally, because petroleum represents a significant 10-12% of the Scottish income from tax. So that would have been a tough one. How it would have been managed is a story for a different day. So we had this result, 55% against independence, 45% for it, which was astonishing because in all my lifetime, independence had scored 30%. It scored 45%. Be careful with referendums. They throw up very extraordinary results. The response to the referendum was devolution 3.0. This was a consequence of the Smith Commission set up immediately after the independence referendum. On the week before the referendum, when one of the polls had put independence at 52% and the union at 48%, Gordon Brown, former Prime Minister, and of course a very strong Scottish Labour MP, and besides, and other parties made this vow that in the event of a no vote, there would be a new round of devolution. So we had the Smith Commission, which delivers a significant shift in tax autonomy for the Scottish Parliament. So now all income tax will attribute to the Scottish Parliament, and the Scottish Government will have the power to set all rates of income tax. They can't affect tax allowances and so on, but they can set the rate of income tax at all bands when this becomes law next year, when it enters implemented next year. Constitutionally, the interesting point made by David Cameron the morning after the independence result was that there would be English votes for English laws. A very controversial proposal that says that Scottish members of Parliament in Westminster cannot vote on an issue declared to be England only by the Speaker. We can talk about that, very difficult. Scottish National Party, a civic national party, lost the battle, but by December 2014, the Scottish National Party membership had soared from 15,000 to 100,000. Now that was some way to lose a referendum. It was an astonishing result. And it now sits about 115,000. Labour voters have deserted the Labour Party in hordes because the Labour Party supported the Better Together campaign, and they are now being punished in political terms for that support with the Conservatives. So we had this extraordinary shift in Scottish politics, such that in 2 weeks' time, when we have a Scottish parliamentary election, the SNP are expected to form another majority government. Again, this is a system of proportional representation. Future of independence, well, the First Minister has said we will have a second referendum, but everybody remembers Quebec. You get two referendums, you don't get three. But the second referendum will only take place where public opinion is consistently supporting independence, and when we have answered, we being the SNP in her view, when they have answered the question about the currency, the question about the European Union, and the question about public spending. So these are issues which are still outstanding, which have to be addressed. And the First Minister has also said, in the summertime, the Scottish National Party will start to look again at these questions. So there's more or less an implicit acceptance that the SNP didn't answer these questions well. Very finally, and any of these points I'm happy to come back to, what do we learn from it? Well, Scotland is prepared to share sovereignty. That was clear. It's always been clear, but it certainly was clear in the independence referendum. Scotland was prepared to share its sovereignty over the currency and the implications that would have for fiscal policy. So the Scottish National Party is not ourselves alone. They see, and I guess we look to the Basque Country here again, the type of economic partnership agreements that you sign with the Spanish government. These are a model for a fully devolved, if not independent, state within a larger entity. Scotland and Europe, again, an exercise in shared sovereignty where the Scottish government has a voice, but it goes through Whitehall. Will the UK become a federal state? No, it won't. There is no demand for self-government in England. And unless and until there was, you can't have a federal state because England is 50 million, 55 million, Scotland is 5 million. It doesn't work as a federal state. We will continue with an uneven devolution. A second referendum, almost certainly yes. The window of opportunity, probably 5 years. The Tory government in London will keep that agitation going. The Labour Party in the UK is not likely to win the 2020 UK election. So as long as there's a Tory government in London, that will feed the Scottish debate because the Tory government in London is a small state government. It's addressing, it's reducing welfare payments and so on. It goes against the social democratic instinct of Scotland. I'll conclude my remarks there and I'll be happy to pick up any questions later on. Thanks.
Bueno, sin perder tiempo, voy a presentar ahora al segundo ponente. Es David Krikimans, nacido en Antwerp. David Krikimans es profesor de política internacional en la Universidad de Antwerp, también profesor de relaciones internacionales en la University College Roosevelt y lector de geopolítica en el Instituto de Estudios Geopolíticos de Ginebra. Desde 2015 es profesor visitante de Relaciones Internacionales en Blanquerna y en la Universidad Ramón Llull de Barcelona, donde imparte, entre otros, política exterior de entidades infraestatales. Ha realizado importantes investigaciones y ha trabajado también como consultor y experto para diversas organizaciones y gabinetes de Flandes. Asimismo, ha colaborado con otros gobiernos de Cataluña o Quebec. David.
Thank you very much.
It's okay, please.
It's okay.
It works.
Yeah. Are you not nervous?
Yeah. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm looking forward to today to compare all these different models. My intake will be a little bit different. I'm going to talk about the Belgian model and also the Flemish case, if you will, but more from the point of view of sub-state diplomacy, so the international relations dimension, because I think there the Belgian model could be somewhat inspiring for the... Doesn't work?
No. Okay.
It's again the headphone, which is making some noise. So, ladies and gentlemen, what is... It's not up there. Okay. Some technical expertise. Ah, yes. Other one? Okay. Yeah. We'll get there. Yeah, I can see it. Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
It's ready.
Yeah, thank you very much. So, ladies and gentlemen, what will I be talking about? I will be talking about more identity and also national coexistence, but also I will be talking about the international relations dimension, so the European interests, if you will. How does the Belgian Federation, if you will, represent itself abroad? Now, very interesting, ladies and gentlemen, is that I think that there's a kind of third wave going on in sub-state diplomacy. The first wave was in the 1980s, when you saw that individual regions in Europe tried to develop external relations, and some of these regions tried to use culture and identity as a lever to present themselves to the outside world. Others focused, for instance, Catalonia, on foreign direct investments and trade and did a lot of initiatives there. But these were more, well, separate initiatives, not very well coordinated, etc. The second wave is more or less in the 1990s, where in different regions, a kind of judicially grounded set of instruments were created to develop a foreign policy, if you will. And more regions started to develop their own administration, if you will, for external relations, not yet called foreign policy, but at least external relations, more or less coordinated in a horizontal way. Now, the third wave, which I think is going on, and you see more and more indications of that, and I think that Belgium is a bit the spearhead there, is a kind of third wave. And this third wave means that the original horizontal administrations for external relations become vertical ministries of foreign affairs, and this is actually happening in Flanders today. These regions try to make choices, both geopolitically and functionally, depending on their consequences, which I will explain in a minute. And also, they attempt to integrate all these instruments of foreign relations, if you will. Now, let's go into the Belgian case, because Belgium, well, is a bit special, but isn't every country special. You know perhaps our famous artist, René Magritte, the man from Surrealism. He's a famous painter. And to a certain extent, also, Belgium is a bit surreal, because we actually have two tiers of regional governments, and this has this has its roots, if you will, in history. On the one hand, there's Wallonia, and I'll bring out a map. So this is Belgium, ladies and gentlemen. On the one hand, you had Wallonia in the southern part of the country. Originally, in the 19th century, all the economic activity was there. It was heavy mining, the steel industry, etc. But from the 1960s onwards, they experienced a severe economic crisis. So this was the political impetus in the Walloon region, if you will, to get those kinds of economic competencies devolved. So they could make tailor-made economic solutions, if you will. So that's why we today in our country have regions. And the regions have mostly economic competencies. This means economy, the environment, employment, infrastructure, environmental planning. It goes on and on and on. It's not completely clear because there are still some competencies of economy that still reside with the federal government. It's so complicated, ladies and gentlemen, that every once in a while the Constitutional Court has to make a final decision on these competencies. So what we call the territorially bounded competencies. But on the other hand, there was Flanders. And you may know that in Flanders we speak Dutch. It's actually the same language as in the Netherlands, only the pronunciation is a bit different. From the 1960s onwards, and this goes back to the original Belgium of 1830, Dutch was, although the Dutch are the majority of the country, Dutch wasn't ingrained, let's say, in the constitution. So this is the reason why in the 1950s, 1960s, especially in Flanders, We originally were not so interested in the economic competencies, we were interested in defending the identity, the culture. Hence, ladies and gentlemen, we have a second tier of regional governments called the communities. And they, on a daily basis, manage language policy, cultural policy, education, a big chunk of the budget, and all the so-called person-bounded competencies. And what are they? Well, they are all the competencies towards individual people. So education is one of them, preventive health care is one of them, aspects of welfare is one of them, although Social Security is still federal, but that could change perhaps in the future. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is also an asymmetric federalism. This means that the Flemish region and the Flemish community have, in practice, been fused together. There's only one Flemish parliament, there's only one Flemish government. In the southern part of the country, there is a Walloon regional government, and there is a French-speaking community government, still separate, although we see that in practice they now have the same minister president. So there is an evolution towards a possible fusion in the south of the country, but it's still not yet there. In external relations, it is there. But that's in a minute. So, ladies and gentlemen, I come from a country with six governments. So if every once in a while one of these governments doesn't work and it takes more than 500 days to form a government, well, but we still have five other governments, of course. We come to foreign policy. And this means that in the period, let's say the 1970s, 1980s, there was already the opportunity for the communities to develop their own foreign policy. So this was more a kind of cultural external relations, if you will. So there was an international cultural affairs department at the Flemish level, but also at the French-speaking community government. And they could, well, conclude treaties, cultural treaties, let's say, with other regions, mostly, or with other countries. But that was the 1970s and the 1980s. The real revolution starts in 1993, when we, in Belgium, adopt a few new principles which actually revolutionize the external relations of the country. The first principle, and it may sound familiar to some of the colleagues, of course, in foro interno, in foro externo. For Quebec, for instance, it's the Gérin-Lajoie doctrine. So what does this mean? Well, it means that on a daily basis, all the competencies that are managed internally also have to be managed externally. So this means, ladies and gentlemen, let's say that a third party, it could also be a country, for instance, let's say Mr. Putin, he wants to approach the Belgian Federation and wants to do a treaty on culture and education, well, then our federal prime minister will have to say, thank you very much, but actually this competency resides with the communities. You can make treaties, but it will be with the regional governments. There's no competency, there's no personnel left at the federal level to conclude this. So the implication is in treaty-making power. Regions and communities can conclude so-called exclusive treaties based on their internal competencies. And the second implication, if you will, is that also the Belgian federated entities, to use a term, can also send their own representatives. So we have, actually, in Flanders, 11 diplomats, Flemish diplomats. They even have a diplomatic passport. How do we sell that abroad? Well, we say to third parties, well, these are diplomats, but they are specialized in the competencies of the regions and the communities. And so there's a kind of agreement that the federal minister of foreign affairs, he will just put them on the diplomatic list. Actually, in the Walloon region or the French-speaking community, they've invested more in this. So they even have 16 diplomatic representatives. So these are representatives to bilateral posts, but also to the European Union. There is a Flemish representation to the European Union. It's actually in the same building as the Belgian representation to the EU. Different floor, different dynamic. Sometimes they do not know each other, which is quite strange. But they have their own political dynamic, if you will. And of course, if more and more competencies reside with the communities and the regions, that has implications for the Belgian position, if you will, in European affairs. Also, by the way, and this is also quite original, I would say, there are also cases, for instance, Catalonia, Quebec, in UNESCO. So this also means in multilateral organizations that Flanders tries to be present. So this is already spearheading perhaps a new evolution in sub-state diplomacy. The second principle, ladies and gentlemen, in the so-called Belgian solution, and you will be shocked, is that there is a fundamental equality among all the Belgian governments. It is a political solution. This means that the federal government is not higher than the regions or the communities. It stands at the same level. It is one of the six. It is perhaps, to use a Latin term, the primus inter pares, and the first among equals. But there is no Bund, there is no Merkel to say, hey, regions or Länder, you're very naughty, now the Bund is going to decide for you. No. It's a bit strange, of course, because it has certain implications. And the implications are, and I hope you can... Yeah, it's clear. All see this. These are the implications, ladies and gentlemen, in terms of the decision-making in foreign affairs. This means, ladies and gentlemen, that Belgium, if it represents its interests abroad, this could either be in bilateral affairs or, more importantly, in European affairs or in international affairs, then first there has to be a very long negotiation in Brussels among all the six governments, so first the officials, the technical officials, and then later on the political officials, by consensus. If there is no consensus, then in practice there is no Belgian salute, a Belgian position, and then we have to, well, then we cannot vote in the international realm. So this creates some pressure on all these Belgian governments to work together, to find the very famous Belgian compromise, which is always a watered-down position. But at least the Belgian negotiators have, for any European issue, already done the negotiation. They've done their homework. They've made a compromise. They perhaps already know where the compromises lie in the negotiations. And then they go to Europe. So it's a disadvantage, but it's an advantage at the same time. So the DGE consultation refers to the Directorate General of European Affairs at the federal level. The federal level has changed its role. Mm-hmm. It's become a kind of coordination center. So they work together in that regard. We have the same in treaties. We have the same in multilateral affairs. And as you see, there's also a political level, the Interministerial Conference on Foreign Policy, and the consultation committee between the Federal Prime Minister and the Minister President. But that doesn't work very well. At least the consultation committee works. They come together on every Friday. But the Interministerial Conference on Foreign Policy only comes together twice a year. Not too much. There are no documents, joint documents, where the regions, the communities, and the federal government agree with one another what are the political priorities for the next 5 years. So there is not a lot of political steering. It's mostly done by the technical people. They do a lot of work. But there's some problems still in the model as we have it today. So, ladies and gentlemen, the Belgian regions and communities can do a lot. They can do a lot. They have the obligation to invest also in foreign policy and to also develop their own positions. And the last couple of years, of course, the Flemish government has also invested quite a lot in European affairs, our Flemish representation to the EU. But of course, the EU still officially recognizes only states. That's a bit of a problem. Where the communities and the regions look at their competencies and say, oh, we have in our portfolio, we have culture, we have economy, we have agriculture, the environment. But then they realize the big decisions are really made at the European level. This is quite a frustration, yes. So actually, the Flemish now understand we have to be actually at a European decision-making level. So there has been a system where in the councils of ministers of the EU, already a regional or community minister can take place, but at that time he or she is only representing the federation as a whole. Now, that system, the Flemish government wants to apply also at COREPER level, so this means the European ambassadors, and also at the European working group level, because then they can be at least present. Now, if they want to influence European decision-making, it's informal, or at the very end, but then it's too late, or strategically with the European Commission, preferably when they float a green paper, when they float some policy ideas. Now, and I've been involved in this process, the current Flemish government is I've been involved in the process as an academic, so this will be interesting strengthen the position of constitutional governments in Europe. Some conclusions, ladies and gentlemen. I said to you already, okay, this is the system, in foro interno, in foro externo, fundamental equality among all the governments. It seems to work somehow, but there's no document on the political priorities. The governments do not always inform one another on their initiatives externally. That's a bit of a problem. And there's a problem in terms of the competencies. There's no homogeneous packages of competencies. It's very heterogeneous. It's very complicated. You have to be a specialist to really understand what's happening. So we are in need, perhaps, of a seventh state reform, because we're already at number seven since 1917. One of the topics on the seventh state reform will probably be streamlining the
settima riforma statale sarà l'allineazione della divisione del comitato.
In the very deep night, and it's not always clear.
Togo se alcanza a través de mucha negociación a altas horas de la madrugada y nunca queda claro. Además, todavía estamos padeciendo el terrible shock de lo que ocurrió el 22 de marzo de este año. Eso también va a tener un efecto en la división de competencias. El problema de Bruselas. ¿Qué ocurre con Bruselas? Con seis diferentes cuerpos de policía, 19 alcaldes, muchos intereses, todo eso va a tener que reformarse y probablemente el gobierno federal aprovechará esta oportunidad para pedir más competencias políticas y eso de hecho es algo que se necesita en Bélgica en el campo de la inversión en la seguridad y en la justicia y los asuntos domésticos, etcétera. Y eso es lo que va a definir nuestro futuro,
so,
yo creo.
At a federal level,
así que a nivel federal, de hecho, a nivel federal ha habido una adaptación a la situación. A nivel federal se ha convertido en un centro de coordinación. Los dinosaurios casi han desaparecido. Hay un nuevo sentimiento de cooperación entre todos.
The region no obstante, por otro lado,
las regiones y las comunidades están asumiendo muchas responsabilidades y aún así van un poco rezagados. No es fácil. Por ejemplo, en el caso de Flandes, de invertir en su representación europea va a ser una inversión muy fuerte. En esta conferencia estamos hablando de ideas y sobre todo de ideas políticas. Quizá les diría, vale, el caso de Bélgica es interesante, pero yo les aviso, no merece la pena copiar el sistema belga, porque no va a funcionar. Cada país tiene que encontrar su propia solución, su propio país, sus distintas identidades.
It's okay? Is it okay?
No, it's okay.
It's good. Then, welcome to Switzerland. In comparison with other countries and other regions, we have spoken from Flanders, we have spoken from Scotland, there is Catalonia, Basque Country. Switzerland is quite different because Switzerland is a very small country and the size of the Switzerland is the size of a European region. Therefore, my presentation will be quite different because I shall speak of a national point of view. That's really different, but I cannot speak of a cantonal point of view because it's really, really too small. Switzerland is famous for its lakes. Switzerland is famous for its mountains. But usually people consider Switzerland first of all for the banks, for the Swiss knife, and for the chocolates. But there is always also something interesting in Switzerland is a myth, the myth of Wilhelm Tell. And what is a myth? It's a popular belief, a story that has become associated with a person, institution, or occurrence, especially one considered to illustrate a cultural ideal. And myth or reality, the historical reality of Wilhelm Tell has been challenged and probably he has never existed, but for the Swiss citizen, it's much more important as if he had existed. And my presentation will show that sometimes myths are important, especially in the constitution or in the legal dimension of an identity. The key element of Switzerland has something mythical, is a federalism. And I shall present federalism as an important means of preserving the central central power of the state with the respect of the cultural identities. And what is federalism? In fact, federalism is a system of government in which there are two levels of government, sometimes three with the municipalities, and combining elements of participation and autonomy. You have participation in the center and autonomy in the regions. It's very important to preserve this balance between the two elements. Very important to keep in mind, especially at the time where my Belgium colleague has said that Belgium is moving into a confederation. Please note that despite its official name of Swiss Confederation, Switzerland is not at all a confederation. It's a pure federation. It's a federal state and not a confederation. Sometimes I hear experts of European Union saying a federation of Europe would be something horrible. The good future for Europe would to be a confederation like Switzerland. It's completely wrong. Switzerland is not a confederation. This is not the atomium in Brussels, it's just a modelization of this idea of federalism with shared rule in the center and self-rule at the periphery. You try to work together for some purposes, but to preserve the self-rule at the periphery. Relevance of federalism, more than 40% of the world population live in this approximately 25 currently existing federations. Of course, the fact that Indian with more than 1 billion inhabitants in the Federation is of great relevance. If we have only to count on Switzerland, Belgium, and Austria, on the Saint Kitts and Nevis for federal countries, it would be much less inhabitants. Federalism is a source of fantasies. All over the world where you speak of federalism, people have just crazy ideas in mind. Some consider federalism as the enslavement of states or regions to the central power. Mm-hmm. They say, we don't want to have a federation because we shall lose all the powers of the regions. Others consider that federalism is just the first step towards the state collapse. For instance, in Ukraine, they do not want to hear of federalism because they say federalism will drive to the state's collapse. Wrong. It's completely wrong. Federalism is not a step towards the enslavement of the regions. It's not destruction of the state. It's just a dialectic balance between center and periphery. And I shall present 7 steps linked to the transformation of a mythical sovereignty into a political reality in the Swiss cantons, in Switzerland, how the myth of the sovereignty of the cantons has been transformed into a political reality. A short historical reminder, the mythical point of view, legal point of view, a practical point of view, financial point of view, democratic, contractual, and participative. And all these point of view will show that in taking great care of living together, it has been possible to transform the mythical idea of the cantonal sovereignty into a political reality. It all started around 1291. This is the first document that we have preserved concerning the history and the union of the 3 cantons. It's very important to keep in mind this historical development in order to show that federalism does not mean only the decentralization, but also the centralization process. These were the 3 first cantons which united in 1291 in order to preserve their liberties defense against the German Empire. And as Switzerland has been founded as a defense against foreign powers, it's not surprising that till now, many, many centuries later, Switzerland is quite reluctant towards Europe because it's very into the DNA of the Swiss to take not to want to link to other countries. The cantons grew and grew because some new cantons joined the first alliance. And it became bigger and bigger, very complicated. At that time, it was a confederation. In 1515, at the time of Marignan, you had this confederation, meaning a very complicated, it could be like Belgium, very complicated union of cantons. There was no common treaty, only separate treaties between 2, 3 or several cantons, and not all cantons were sovereign, some cantons were allies. It was very complicated. And then we have started to have for a certain number of centuries the so-called Confederation of 13 cantons. It was extremely complicated, extremely weak structure, but fortunately, Swiss cantons said that they were neutral, and this neutrality has played a very big role in the history of the Switzerland because no other empire or no other power wanted to attack a neutral country because it was good to have these poor cantons in the middle of Europe. They were able to be placed for negotiations, for trade or something, and the neutrality was very important. Everything has changed in 798. Napoleon invaded Switzerland and transformed the vague confederation into a Helvetic Republic, centralized, one and indivisible, like France. The cantons have been transformed into departments. And for 5 years, there were only riots and riots because people did not enjoy this. And the people in the cantons, they wanted to have their independence and they wanted to preserve their identity. So they had to change the system, and after the collapse of Napoleon, cantons were again independent, fully independent. But times have changed. And in the modern world, modern 19th century, to have all these independent cantons, very, very small. Some cantons are extremely small. The smallest cantons in Switzerland, which is a full-fledged canton with its authorities, parliament, government, has 15,000 inhabitants. It's micro-cantons, micro-sovereignty. It was no more possible. If you wanted to travel from Geneva to Zurich, it took 1 week to cross all the cantons with all the borders, the taxes, the controls, the customs. It was shorter to travel through France and Germany. Impossible. And there were tensions between Catholic cantons who wanted to preserve the status quo and Protestant cantons who wanted to have a federation. And these tensions drove to the war, a civil war, the Sonderbund War, a war between the Catholic and the Protestant cantons. Fortunately, the Catholic cantons were very weak and lost the war very, very quickly, so that the war was not too horrible and with not too many casualties. But the Protestant progressist cantons could impose in 1848 the creation of a federation like United States of America, the first federation of modern world. Switzerland is the second. But from that time, it means that as all cantons were not so enthusiastic to merge into a federation, they had to take care of their cantons. And from that moment, Swiss authorities needed to take care, to try to take care of the specificities of the canton, not to frustrate the cantons. And they succeeded quite well, because 2 centuries later, it functions quite well. The mythical dimension which has been used to reach that goal is in the 1848 Constitution. You have in the preamble the notion to maintain and to promote the unity. And this is important, as I mentioned to you previously, for federalism. Federalism means the preservation of the unity of the country, not to create something just a disintegration. It's to promote the unity of the country, but at the same time to recognize the difference between the cantons. So you have in the same dimension of the Constitution, maintain the unity and to call the 22 sovereign cantons. And the Article 3 says the cantons are sovereign. It's not really true from international law, but it was a gift made to the canton to explain that they are sovereign. And this notion still appears in the last constitution, the 1999 constitution. We had 3 constitutions in the Swiss history, and it's the same in the preamble. You have the Swiss people and the cantons determined to live together with mutual consideration and respect for their diversity, and cantons are sovereign. They exercise all rights that are not vested in the confederation. The provision has not changed in the history. The legal dimension, the first part of this provision, in 1848, it was an idea to make a construction of the federal state. At that time, most of the countries in the world were kingdoms, very united kingdoms, and it was very difficult to try to find a theoretical construction of the federation, how to speak of federation, of shared sovereignty. It was also a programmatic and a political dimension, because they had to create a federation. Cantons were not so happy to join and to merge, so it was necessary to take care and to still consider canton as little states. Since the end of World War II, it's only the programmatic dimension. Because of the internationalization, because of the globalization, it's no more so important to define and to make the theoretical construction of the federal state, because the states have lost a great part of their importance. And we have seen in Belgium, you have 5 different governments, you have everywhere cantons, but you have also international organization. You have all these international things which make the notion of state, region, canton less important than in the 19th century. Therefore, the programmatic dimension is more important. The second part of the provision says that the cantons are sovereign insofar as their rights are not transferred to the central power. And the transfers of power to the federal state need a mandatory referendum. If cantons want to transfer their power to the central state, to the confederation, they have to change the constitution, to amend the constitution, and it needs a double majority, a majority of the cantons and a majority of the voters. It means that you respect very well the principle of subsidiarity, because it is absolutely impossible to deprive the cantons of their rights without the consent of a majority of cantons. If cantons accept to lose powers, they have to agree of this loss of power. It can happen because cantons are so small that many times they consider that they cannot deal anymore with a certain topic. For instance, in matter, the last time was the question of criminal and civil procedure. It was no more possible to have 27 criminal procedure in a country or 27 civil procedure. It was too complicated. They had to unite this. Now, I speak of the practical dimension. The Federal Council, in 1848 until now, they have decided as a head of state not to have one king, one president, but to have a group of people, because the idea was that in the 26 cantons, 25 at that time, nobody would accept to have one president coming from one canton. It was better to have seven persons coming from seven different cantons, so all the cantons could be, or all the parts of Switzerland would be preserved. This is the official picture of the Federal Council in 2016, because the president changes every year, and there are seven persons. The eight persons of the on the picture is the Chancellor of the Confederation, meaning the Secretary of the Federal Council. And in the 1848 Constitution, it was written, the Federal Council, only one member, however, is allowed to be chosen from the same canton. The idea was to respect the cantons so that at least seven different cantons would be part in the Federal Council. And the Federal Assembly has elected the first Federal Council in 1848 with some representatives from the canton of Zurich, Vaud, Bern, Solothurn, Tessin, St. Gallen, and Aargau. Seven different cantons. Please note that till 1848, it has never been necessary to replace the Federal Council altogether. Only one member after the other, so that the continuity of the Federal Council goes till 848. Never change it. You have always the same government till 1848, and there have been around 110 members of the Federal Council. And you see on this paper, on this map, that they have chosen from the early beginning people from some big cantons, and among the majority, the German-speaking majority, at least two members are not speaking German. Here you have one French-speaking and one Italian-speaking. Another interesting practical dimension is the consultation procedure. Before any law, for every draft of law, cantons are invited to express their views. Contrary to France, where the government takes a law, and the next Monday you have 1 million people in the street contesting the law, and the next Tuesday the government has to say we stop the draft and we make what we call in French rétropédalage. In Switzerland, cantons are invited to express their views. If I take the financial dimension, cantons, confederation, and municipalities, they all take taxes. So my neighbor spoke of the financing problem in Great Britain. In Switzerland, the three levels of the confederation have their taxes. And the taxes are allocated, the income tax, the tax on income and wealth belongs to the cantons, and the confederation has the indirect taxes. There is a financial equalization. And if we take the situation in 2010, but it's the same every year, The budget of the state is divided 34% to the confederation, 42% for the cantons, and 23% for the municipalities. You have the congruence between revenue and expenditure. If you see the famous round graphic, you see that cantons represent the majority of the national good. It has two consequences. Money follows power, no golden leash. The cantons, they can do what they want. They are not completely dependent from the money coming from the center. This is very important in many, many decentralized countries where regions are completely limited because they have to ask money from the central government. In Switzerland, it's not the case. But of course, in the other direction, no central government in the world would be ready for such a loss of control. The central government in Switzerland controls only 1/3 of the money. And of course, to transform a central power into a federation like this would mean that the central government would lose 2/3 of its financial control. Nobody would accept that. The democratic dimension. There is constitutional referendum, we have seen. We have also the popular initiative. And it has also to be accepted with the double majority. The initiative means that 100,000 citizens can ask for an amendment of the constitution. It's very powerful. These initiatives are accepted very seldom, but they play a very important role because they put on the political agenda some topics that nobody wanted to have. Two examples. The initiative of the Christian Democratic Party against tax discrimination for married couples. It was very recent. We had the vote last month. The initiative contains an ulterior motive. They propose the Catholic Party, the Christian Democratic Party, the Catholic Party, and it was an initiative aiming at a tax equality between married couples and non-married couples. But he wanted to put into the constitution the phrase saying that marriage is the union of a man and a woman. That had nothing to do, of course, with taxation. And it was an ulterior motive because they knew that because of the cantonal referendum and the majority of conservative cantons once the dimension of marriage between a man and a woman would be enshrined in the constitution, it would be never more possible to have in Switzerland same-sex marriage. And you see very well on this the result of the vote, a majority of cantons has accepted, but a light majority of voters have rejected this text. That was interesting because it shows that from a political point of view, you rely on the cantons. You can try to rely on the cantons in order to reach something. And another example, there was a link, a social reform of family policy in 2013, and this has been accepted by a majority of citizens, but torpedoed by a majority of cantons. As I told you, cantons are mostly conservative, and they have rejected this social amelioration. And I have no more time to go, but just 9 times in the history, a majority of cantons torpedoes a draft approved by the majority of citizens, meaning that from a democratic dimension, cantons have a certain power. Direct democracy exists also in the cantons. Every year, there are hundreds of votes in the 26 cantons. They can vote on many, much more things at the federal level. They can vote on constitution, laws, finance, and you have a lot of direct democracy in the cantons, meaning that the cantons are real states where you have discussion on laws, discussion on finance, discussion on constitution. A contractual dimension. Treaty-making powers belong to the classical feature of the states. There are a lot of intercantonal agreements because cantons are so small that they have signed an enormous amount of agreements because they have to work together in order to reach a certain power. And for instance, the cantons, they have linked all together in order to create the House of the Cantons in Bern in order to make a counterweight to the federal administration. It's just close to the federal building, and cantons have this beautiful building in Bern saying, we are here, take care of us. And for instance, the contractual dimension, here you have the treaty on the harmonization of school. It's important because they do not want to have or to give a power to the confederation. They want to preserve the power of the cantons, but they have to go to work all together for that. The contractual dimension goes also outside. The canton can have a diplomatic activity. They can conclude treaty with foreign states. One example is the SEVA. It's the creation of a very big, it costs 2 billion francs, a big transportation network linking Geneva with France, and it implies, you see all the people who have signed this agreement, it links Switzerland and France, but also Geneva with France and with Savoie, with the neighbor regions. Participatory dimension, the Swiss like very much to participate in the political debate. Some cantons continue to have the Landsgemeinde. It's the place you have all the citizens sitting in the place and they can vote in the rising hand. And cantons shall participate in the federal decision making. They shall be consulted on foreign policy. They have asked for that. They have made a lobbying for that. Some concluding remarks. In 1848, you had the myth of the shared sovereignty. It was impossible to consider that cantons could be sovereign. 168 years later, the myth became reality. Cantons are still little states. They consider some cantons call themselves republics. And meanwhile, not a single trend or tendency towards secession. There has never been any trend of secession among the Swiss cantons. Unity of the state and the specificities of the cantons have been preserved. The last word is to say, to take care of its regions in the best investment for a state's bright future. And I just have to say thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Bueno, y paso a presentar el cuarto ponente de esta mañana. Él es Philippe Steel, legeetan doktore da, 2014-tik Bavierako Estatu Kantzilerian Lege Departamentuko burua. Aurretik beste makina bat kargu ere izan ditu, irakasle bezala lan egin zuen, kargu ezberdinak izan ditu Bavariako ministaritza ezberdinetan, batez ere ekonomia, garraio eta teknologia ministaritzan, eta 2001-tik Bavierako Estatu Kantzilerian. 2007-tik 2014-ra adibidez Batasun Europarreko Bavierako ordezkaritzaren burua izan da Bruselan. Kanpo arazotan ere ibilitakoa da, garapenerako kooperazio arloan, Hans-Seidel fundazioko aditu bezala, adibidez, Nigerren, Burkina Fason, Marokon, Tunisian eta Mongolian. Philippe Steel, zurea da hitza.
Microphone, you can hear me? Yeah, sounds nice. Thank you very much for that introduction, and of course, thank you very much for the invitation. Mr. President, as I'm a governmental official, I have first of all to give the greetings of the Bavarian government, and especially from the Minister of International Relations and EU Affairs, Beate Merk, whom you met, I think, last year. Since we have quite strong links between Bavaria and the Basque Country. The Basque Country has opened its own representation in Munich in 2014. We have a partnership agreement, and I'm very glad that here in the room there are more representatives of countries and regions like Scotland, where we do have partnerships. Bavaria has a tradition of more than 1,000 years of being a state. But the majority of this time, the state of Bavaria has always been part of Germany, but the federal Germany. Germany has been, with the exception from 12 not very happy years, always been a federal state on a different degrees. If I take the definition of Mr. Schmidt, or the well-common known definition, that federalism means shared rule in the center and self-government in the parts, then we can always talk about a federal state, Germany as a federal state. That started in the Holy Roman Empire of German nation, which was formed by a multitude of smaller and bigger countries, reigned by dukes, princes, archbishops, and different others. Amongst them was Bavaria as a duchess. The Holy Roman Empire of German nation was a federal state, because you had the self-governments in these little states, smaller or bigger states, but in the same time, the heads of these states did elect the German emperor. This continued to be like that and went through the period of the Second Reich under Bismarck, which was, of course, marked by a Prussian domination, very bad for us Bavarians, but also what we call Bavarian reserved rights. That means that Bavaria kept to have his own army, kept to have his own diplomatic representatives. The Bavarian army, the commander-in-chief, was the king of Bavaria, and it just shifted in times of war to the king or the German emperor, king of Prussia. Also under the Republic of Weimar, it was a federal system with a two-chamber system. And after the Second World War, after the Nazi time, it became again a federal system. And even a federal system in its most genuine form, as I would say, meaning that it is the states who decided to come together into a federation and not the federation deciding to be split it into members. If you read the German constitution, which is called the Grundgesetz, the basic law from 1949, it says in its preamble that the people in the Länder of Bavaria, Baden-Württemberg, and so on have decided to establish the Bundesrepublik Deutschland. And it also said that it enters, this basic law enters into force if it is voted positively in the majority of the Länder parliaments. So there was no German referendum. There was no voting on the federal level. There was only a voting in the Länder parliaments. You would say it's no surprise because there was no federal parliament at that time. But after the war, it was first in 1946 established the Länder with their parliaments, and then in 49, the federal level. And if you find old coins from the Deutschmark, which have been stamped shortly after the war, it is not written Bundesbank on it, that institution which has a quite interesting reputation all over Europe, but it is written Bank der Deutschen Länder, Bank of the German Länders. And that shows that first have been the Länders and then has been the Federation, the Bundesrepublik. Something which you have to remind Berlin from time to time. Talking about the status quo, so the construction, very shortly, just to give you a picture, the construction of the German federal system. It is very similar, I think, in some points there are some similarities with the Belgian system and also with the Swiss system. The legislative power is a shared one. The basic law says, the principle is that the legislative power lays within the Länder. Only if it stipulates that it's on the federal level, or if it is a framework law, or there is a so-called competition legislation between Länder and Bund, then it's not of the Länder. I don't want to go into the technical details of that. I don't want to bore you. But the consequence is that in practice, despite that the basic law says principally it's a Länder competency, 90%, I would say, of all the laws are either on EU level or on federal level, and 10% is left on the Länder level. Despite that, there is a couple of reserved domains which are purely of the lender competency. And as you say, it is a matter of cultural identity in federalism. So no wonder it is the field of culture, the field of media policy, the field of primary and secondary education, which is exclusive lender competency, but also internal security, which means policing. That also means that on EU level, when it comes to those matters, we have on the level of the working groups and on the level of the Ministers' Committee, of the Council of the Ministers, a representation of Germany by both, by the federal level and the lender level. So the lender do agree whom to send to Brussels to represent them in those matters. So for culture and for media policy, it was Bavaria, with the consequence that I was sitting together with the colleague, the diplomat from the federal level, in the working group, and that in the Minister's Council was sitting the federal minister as well as my minister representing the German lender, which might be a problem. Not because we do have internal fights, we manage to hide them in front of the others, but when it comes to the ministers, the Council of Ministers, the Secretariat General of the Council has decided that on the Ministers' Council is only one seat per member state. So what to do if you are there with two ministers? It's really boring, I can tell you, because then you have to fight who should sit in front and who sits in the second row with all that civil servants. And it's not nice for a minister to stand up and to walk back and another one coming up front. Well, we tried to change that, but well, unfortunately, in vain. Where we don't have, and we do invite Belgium a lot for that, where we don't have a seat is in the Corepair. There also, in our own competences, culture, media, education, we have to rely on the German ambassador sitting there, which is a bit awkward, because when it comes to primary and secondary education, there is no federal administration for that. There is no federal minister for primary and secondary education, no school minister. It simply doesn't exist. And so it's a bit awkward and a bit weird that the ambassador is representing a minister who does not exist. Bon. Voilà, les choses sont comme ça. But as you say, it is not only the matter of self-governance in your own affairs, but it's also a matter of shared rule in the central level. So the influence of the lender on the federal level in the federal legislation is of utmost importance. Almost all of the laws need to pass in the second chamber of the federal parliament. You have the federal parliament directly elected, and you have a second chamber called the Bundesrat. Technically, it's not really a second chamber, but put aside that. And the Bundesrat is represented, the government are represented, the government of the lender. If there is a disagreement between the Bundesrat, the second chamber, and the Bundestag, the parliament, there has to be a joint committee of conciliation and to find a common solution. At the end, it depends on the degree how much the lender are, or how big is the impact of the intended law on the lender. If it is a big impact, we have a blocking right, that if that committee does not come to a solution, then chuck, the law is blocked. That is when we talk about legislation. When we talk about the executive power, there also the basic law says all executive power is a competency of the lender, except but there the practice goes in line with that, what the basic law, what the federal constitution says. In practice, really, the large, large, large majority, I would say 80-90% of the laws are executed by the lender. A federal administration exists only in diplomacy, in military affairs, in the federal agency of employment, and the federal police force, which is basically the border policing. Now let's come to the very core issue, tax and finance. That is the crucial point, that's clear. We do have, maybe to start institution-wise, we do have a joint administration when it comes to the tax perception. That means the lowest level is lender level, the middle level is mixed one, we call it Androgyn. Androgyn. That means it's administration which is double-headed, it has two logos, it has the coat of arms of the Federal Republic and ours, so that is the middle level, and of course there is a federal level. But it's one administration, the tax administration. There are no self-perceived lender taxes. We have no tax administration perceiving our own taxes. They are taxes which are dedicated to the lender. Less important ones like the tax on beer and alcohol beverages, and more important ones like the tax on succession rights. They are dedicated to the lenders but perceived by our joint administration. And for the rest, well, it's a matter of equalization. And there we have two mechanisms. We have a vertical distribution, which means that perceived taxes will be distributed between or shared between the federal level and the lender, and then according to some very complicated formula between the lender. But we also do have a horizontal distribution. Means after all of that, when the lender got their money, they sit on the money, they say, so, and now we have to equalize a little bit because they are rich lender like Bavaria and poor ones. And between us, amongst us, we will do a redistribution. That's what we call horizontal distribution or lender Finanzausgleich, nice German word. That is highly contested at the moment. By whom? By us, because we are paying. Look, that's logic. Currently, there are three lenders paying into this horizontal distribution and 13 getting out of it. The extrema are Bavaria giving the most in and Berlin getting the most out, which is actually for us a bit of a problem. And there I come to the second part, our actual discussions. The biggest discussion goes really around this money issue. And it's not only Bavarian angriness, because we are the biggest payer. We have been 40 years receiver of that money. But we also have to say that in the last 10 years, we paid much more money than we received the last 40 years. It's a completely different dimension. And even if you take into calculation the inflation, so it's talking in today's money. But it's only a democratic problem, because how can you sell it to the Bavarian taxpayer that he pays the money to something or to some entity where he has no right to decide? You give money which has been from the Bavarian taxpayer, let's say to Bremen, and Bremen has the luxury of paying themselves an agency for development aid in Africa. Nice to have, with 200 people, with 200 employees. Costs a lot, and it's not really their task. So, of course, the people in Bavaria ask themselves the question, is that really needed? Or, in Berlin, you have the right to put your child free of charge in a kindergarten. In Bavaria, it costs something. You have to pay for that. How to explain to the Bavarian taxpayer that he has to pay in Bavaria and he has to give money to Berlin, that there the children go in the kindergarten for free? That's a bit difficult. And it is also, as I said, a problem of legitimacy. Don't misunderstand me. It's not that we put into question the solidarity. Because you see in this question really two principles of federalism fighting with each other. On the one hand, the principle of solidarity and cohesion, and on the other hand, the principle of self-governance and subsidiarity. But we do think that without putting into question the principle of solidarity, there must be also some incentive for those countries who take the money to rebalance a bit this equilibre between giving and receiving countries. So that is a very big ongoing discussion. And I really think that one of the key factors of success for federalism is that it might be smooth and adaptive and is able to change. As you said, you have the seventh state reform ahead of you. But the first key factor, I think, is a clear distinction between the competencies of the level, of the levels. It must be a catalogue and not a general clausula, because the general clausula will bring you automatically all the time in front of the Constitutional Court. I mean, that is a bit the experience. And that is on the core of our critics towards the European Union and towards the Treaty of Maastricht and also Lisbon, is it mentions subsidiarity. Yes, it's true, but at the end, it always comes to the general clausula that when it comes to competition, market competition, internal market, it's the EU Commission who can propose something. And everything, if you need it, everything has a link to the internal market. It's very difficult to find something where it's not. And there you have the general clausula which causes in the daily politics problems. As I said, it is not static. The key factor of success is the clear distinction, but also that it is smooth and adaptive. For that reason, we had two commissions of federalism, or of the evaluation and development of federalism, in view of strengthening the principle of subsidiarity and of streamlining the competencies. And one of the outcomes was, surprising enough, of the second commission, that now the lender have the right to establish their own payment scheme for the civil servants. Means a civil servant of the same rank on the federal level or in different lenders can get a different salary, which is surprising, which is maybe a bit selfish because the rich lender can pay more. And there we come to the next point, key factor of success, competition. But it is a bit of a competition thing, because I'm not allowed, as Bavaria, if I employ somebody, to discriminate somebody who comes from another German land. I can only employ according to their proficiency and their level of qualification. And if there's a candidate from Berlin and a candidate from Bavaria, and the one from Berlin has the better qualification, I have to take him, even if he doesn't speak my dialect or my language. And if I pay better than Berlin, well, you will have a lot of candidates from Berlin. It's like that. But it brings you to a certain competition, and it forces Berlin also to enter in that competition and to get better. And internally with us, for the Bavarian candidates, it means to be better than the Berlin ones. That makes a certain competition between the candidates, but also between the lender. Same goes for the education system. The qualification which you get at the end of secondary education, the access to the university, we call it Abitur, Matura, Baccalaureat. It's not comparable. If you have a Bavarian Abitur, it's different than the one from Hamburg. And the enterprises, the companies, when they hire people, they even have a ratio how to calculate that. They say from the Bavarian marks, you have to multiply it with 0.5, I don't know what, and then you can compare it to the one with Hamburg. Quite funny, very often contested, but I think, and the practice shows, it's manageable to have that. The universities can deal with it, the companies can deal with it, so why to abandon it? And it has another advantage, which I think is really a basic advantage in federalism, is that you can see political concepts in reality. If you have a central state, the opposition can explain their concepts, can explain their ideas, but they can never prove that it works in real life unless they are in power. If you have 16 lenders, half of them are, let's say, governed by the socialists, and that's 16 lenders, they can show if their concepts work. And the same goes for the conservatives. And you have the reality check or the reality test for those concepts. In that same perspective, and I have to speed up, I think, right? In the same perspective, it's that ongoing discussion to have the taxes of succession rights that the lender might define their own level of taxation. About the EU aspects, we did talk. I say they noted here envy for Belgium, we do have sometimes big fights with the federal level when it comes on defending the own competences of the lender. And there, I would just briefly mention maybe one element which I think is very important. It's the element of loyalty, which we call Bundestreue, and it means the lender have to be loyal towards the federation, but also the other way around. So I have been 7 years in Brussels at the Bavarian representation to the European Union, and I never did something publicly to to make angry or to contradict the federal government. But I expect from the federal government the same thing, to respect our interests and our competencies. When it comes to the vote, because it was mentioned a couple of times, the famous German vote, which means abstention in the Minister's Council, because we cannot agree internally on our position. That's a myth, but unlike the Swiss one, ours is not true. Actually, France is much more often abstaining than Germany. And I can tell you from my own practice that it goes very, very quick if needed. The German ambassador calls you and says, here's the intention to vote in this and this way in the Coreper. Mm-hmm. I call, because I'm the leader of the so-called B-lenders, the lender governed by a conservative chief of government. So I call my colleague from the A-lender, the lender with the socialists, Prime Minister, and I say, listen, the German ambassador wants to do that. Is that okay with you? For us, it's fine. And he says, yes or no. And then I can call him and say, it's fine. You can go ahead. Takes me, I don't know, 5 minutes. If it's more complicated, we do write an email to all of the lender colleagues and say, today by noon, we need an answer from you. If it's silence, means yes. Mm? And this way, we really can reduce it to the very, 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 very core of questions where you have a serious conflict. And in that case, it's true, the German ambassador has to abstain or the German minister has to abstain. But that is very, very rarely, because those cases where you have a big fight, normally they don't pop up like this. You are in the discussion since long and normally you find a way how to vote. Shortly, refugee crisis was or has been a bit of a test of our system. We had last year, end of the year, each day on the Bavarian border to Austria, 10,000 people arriving. Each day. It's funny. The border regime is normally a federal regime, but it went to a point where we said we will send the Bavarian police there to secure our own border, which is identical with the federal border. And to say, okay, and if we are asked, and they say, it's not your business to defend the federal border, we'll say, we'll not defend the federal one, we defend the Bavarian one. By any chance, it's the same. also meant that the whole setup for medical assistance, registering, accommodation, distribution of the refugees is normally a task of the Bund, but he didn't manage. It took him 3 months to set up a crisis cell, to involve the army, to involve the federal police, to involve all the federal institutions to take care. Well, meanwhile, simply we did that, which means that you need a certain smoothness to deal with that. And also because that is a highly political issue, Chancellor Merkel has welcomed the refugees. Her speech after Budapest has been understood in Syria and elsewhere as an open invitation. And she goes on with that policy without having asked the lender, who have the main burden on their shoulders, which is why we are preparing at the moment a complaint to the federal court saying that it was illegal of the chancellor to take such a decision, such a far-going decision, without having talked to us and without having involved the legislational, the legislative or the legislator on federal level, which means also the Bundesrat. As a conclusion, well, and I'm almost in time, as a conclusion, I think for a successful federalism or federal system, you need a solid framework, of course, but it must be adaptive and smooth, and I think you need the spirit of loyalty on both levels, federal and in the member states. Thank you very much for your attention.
Mil esker, Islari, hoy. Muchas gracias a los cuatro ponentes por ajustaros al tiempo. Y en los minutos que nos quedan de aquí a las 11:30, pues como les he anunciado antes, voy a plantear, empiezo con una, cada ponente, con una pregunta y luego veremos si hay tiempo para una segunda. Y empiezo, pues como en el orden que hemos empezado antes, la primera pregunta es para el profesor Scott. Me interesa profundizar en el derecho a decidir. El derecho a decidir, en su opinión, es siempre algo pactado, necesita ser algo pactado, y si no hubiera pacto,
do you mean in everyday policy, or do you mean in the constitutional debate?
In the constitution.
Okay, so in the UK, the UK government and the Scottish government agreed that whatever the result of the independence referendum, that would be binding. Now, that was a dispensation given by the UK government because the constitution is a reserved matter. And that was one of the main reasons that when I was working on the EU, the European Union dimension, what distinguished Scotland from other jurisdictions, other sub-state nations, in seeking independence within the European Union. Because unlike, for example, in Spain, the UK government did say they would permit independence, they would permit the vote, They would allow a referendum to take place. There was a debate whether the Scottish government could have a referendum itself, because referendums have to have finances assigned to them to pay for the referendum, and it could be legally challenged that a referendum that was financed by the Scottish Parliament's income would be illegal under the allocation of powers. So in 2014, the referendum was completely agreed. Both parties agreed to be bound by the result. And again, constitutions have no legal status. Referendums have no legal status in the UK, no constitutional legal status. Now, this is interesting because, of course, the First Minister of Scotland, Nicola Sturgeon, has made it clear that she reserves the right to call a second referendum. And one of the triggers that may drive a second referendum, of course, is the Brexit debate. Because the Scottish government, none of the devolved administrations were involved in the negotiations of the UK government over the new terms of UK membership. How non-important they are is irrelevant. But the Scottish government was not involved in those negotiations. And given that one of the areas was migration, that was unfortunate because migration has a very important economic impact. Now, what the UK government has said is that there will not be a second referendum. They will not legislate for a second referendum. This UK government, okay, so UK governments can change, of course, and they can change their minds. So there is a very big constitutional question that if the Scottish National Party are in government in Scotland, and if they decide that the time is right for a second referendum, for example, if Brexit happens, then the constitutionality of that second referendum may be contested. My own view is that politically, it would be virtually impossible for the UK government to stop a second referendum. Politically, it would be a huge step. So I think there will be a second referendum. I don't know when, obviously. And be clear, the Scottish government does not want Brexit. They don't want to be forced to have a second referendum, not at a time of their choosing, because Brexit would be a second force majeure. They wouldn't be calling it. They would be, if you like, forced into it. And until they feel confident that they've answered the questions, then I think they would be reluctant to have a second referendum. But it's a very good point. But I think a UK government of any colour would find it difficult to say no.
Thank you very much. La segunda pregunta para el profesor Krikimans. A ver, muchas preguntas. Pero voy a empezar con una. El reconocimiento de un sujeto colectivo, nacional, subestatal, ¿supone el reconocimiento simultáneo de su soberanía?
Yeah. Thank you very much. So if I understand correctly, you are referring to the representation of Belgium
yes.
Externally, and what does this... Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Excuse me. So what does this mean for externally for the sovereignty? Well, actually, if you look at the competencies, they have been divided. So we are not in a system of shared competencies. So actually, the representation, if you will, externally, so every government, in fact, has its own role to play in representing a part of the sovereignty of Belgium, if you will. So that's really how it works. So what I try to show you is that competencies have been divided. There's an equality among the governments. So this means that in the external representation, each government has its own role to play, actually. And that's perhaps also the difficulty, because we are now in a transition where regions and communities have to invest, of course, in their ministries of foreign affairs, if you will. And it's difficult to keep up. For instance, let's take agriculture as a competency, which is a big chunk of the money. I know for Scotland, this is also very important together with fisheries. Yes, indeed, there are investments at the regional level to represent Belgium there, but the intensity of the negotiations at the European level is so high that there is an exception. The federal government has to help the regions because they cannot keep up with all these meetings and the technicalities, etc. So there are still a lot of problems there.
Thank you. Vamos a ver. Para el profesor Smith, mi pregunta Bueno, más que preguntas, por la brevedad, probablemente se ha mencionado la democracia directa, ¿no? Pero me gustaría que aprovecháramos este tiempo para profundizar un poco más en el papel que juega, en el caso suizo, la democracia directa en el sistema democrático suizo.
Okay. Thank you for the question. It could be a very long answer because direct democracy is very important for everything in Switzerland because at the end, every important decision is taken by the citizen. Therefore, in Switzerland, we speak of the people sovereign. Direct democracy plays a role at the federal level because all the constitutional amendments have to be adopted by a popular vote. At the cantonal level also, all the constitutional amendments have to be adopted by the citizens. And we have this initiative. This initiative is the possibility given at the federal and at the cantonal level that a certain number of citizens ask for a constitutional amendment. At the federal level, it's only constitution. At the cantonal level, you can ask for the amendment of a law or of the constitution. It plays an important role because it allows citizens to launch on the political debate some topics that no politician wants to discuss about. And of course, it's interesting because you then it's the engine of the Swiss political life, the engine of the Swiss democracy, because nothing can be hidden. Because if the government does not want to discuss with something, I give you just two examples. We had this famous vote on the minarets, the interdiction of the minarets. This initiative has been launched because people wanted that the government takes position on Islam. And so they could not launch an initiative like we throw away all the Muslims or something like this. So they have taken minarets as a symbol. And very stupidly, the government, instead of saying, yes, this shows some concerns about the relations between Switzerland and Islam, the government answers, no, it's a stupid initiative because there are no minarets in Switzerland. It's just a question of construction. And we don't want to discuss about this. Result, the citizens have voted yes to this initiative because they wanted to have a discussion. They wanted to explain their concerns on Islam. And therefore, direct democracy allows for that. But direct democracy has also some problematic aspects. For instance, the fact to join the European Union. Switzerland has a very strange position in comparison with the European Union because of direct democracy. Joining European Union would require a political vote, a political referendum, with a double majority of Swiss and cantons, and everybody knows that never the Swiss will vote yes for joining the European Union. As I said to you, it's against the DNA of Swiss. They will never accept that. Therefore, we are completely locked. And it seems that Switzerland is very much integrated in Europe, much more than other European countries, but we will never be member of the European Union because never the Swiss will accept this. Sometimes the direct democracy means that you have a lot, it takes a lot of time. We have been the last country to join United Nations. 190. Only Vatican is no more a member of the United Nations because we are the only country in which the citizen had to vote to join the United Nations. It was the same problem with the right to vote for women. For many other countries, in 1945, General de Gaulle said, from now on, women can vote in France. In Switzerland, no, we had to wait for a vote of a majority of men giving the right to vote to women. It took a lot of time. At the end, it took time, place only in 1971 for Switzerland and in the 90s for some cantons which are very conservative and did not want to give the right to vote to women. So the direct democracy can be very interesting, but can make a lot of problems. It obliges the government to deal very, very much with all things. But also, It means that the direct democracy is a Damocles sword on the parliament, because the parliament can never take a decision that is too revolutionary. Because you know that at the moment something is too revolutionary, you have the referendum. So you have long, long, long discussions in the parliament, always trying to avoid the referendum, because you know that it could be politically tricky. Therefore, in Switzerland, it takes 10 or 20 years to adopt a new law. It takes a lot of time, but when I compare with France, I think it's really a good solution, because we avoid these clashes of these laws which are not accepted. In Switzerland, because of direct democracy, it takes a lot of time to discuss everything with the citizens, with the interest group, in order to avoid too much pressure from the direct democracy.
Thank you very much. Valores democráticos muy enraizados. Para el caso de Baviera, también va por este terreno, ¿no? Usted ha mencionado problemas diarios en la articulación del Estado, pero al fin y al cabo es un sistema que funciona y mi pregunta es, ¿cómo se alcanza el respeto total a las singularidades y el no, la articulación entre el respeto total a las singularidades y el no cuestionamiento del Estado? En su opinión, ¿cuál es la clave? Entiendo que va por la misma línea de valores democráticos, una cultura democrática enraizada que usted, y el principio solidario que usted ha mencionado.
Thank you. Just to switch that off. Well, I think it is, first of all, it's probably rooted in history. King Ludwig I of Bavaria said, we want to become Germans and stay Bavarians. I think it's a bit lazy in that. And it's always a bit, in the time of history, it's always a bit shifting. Sometimes Bavaria is more loyal to the central level, sometimes a bit less. Has been very constant, I think, during the last 60 years. There is no very serious idea of independence. Sometimes there is, sometimes it pops up. Sometimes we use it to frighten a bit Berlin, but it's not serious. It's as you have a dog and the dog is attacking you, you say, yeah, it just wants to play. but so we use it, but it's, I can remember, I think some 20 years ago, we wrote in my department, in the State Chancery, the law department, we wrote a paper, how to get out of Germany. Legally, and it's been locked up in the toxic shelf since then. I think you need the spirit, as I say, the spirit of loyalty, of mutual respect of the two levels. That does not exclude that you have fights. I think it's even necessary. It's like in a marriage. In a good marriage, you fight. If there's never a fight, it's a bit doubtful if it's a good one. Because you fight for solutions. It's you don't find to attack the other because you can stand him or her. It's you fight for the solution. And I think that is normal and mutual. And as I have told in Brussels, the famous fight over the seats, you fight for a solution, that's it. But you always keep in mind that in a spirit of belonging together and to have to face the problems together. That is that famous loyalty. Nevertheless, of course, you have to hinder that some in this circle will lay back and do nothing and leave the job to you. And I think it's always in this dialectic that you fight for a solution, but in the end, you never put into question the very back, the very front of it. I don't know if I hit completely your question.
Una pregunta más, no sé si me dará tiempo de hacer la segunda tanda de preguntas en los 7-10 minutos que nos quedan, pero lo intentaremos. En el caso escocés, el problema del separatismo en el Reino Unido se ha tratado desde el diálogo reposado y la negociación por ambas partes, ¿no? ¿Qué ha ganado Escocia y qué ha ganado el Reino Unido?
Well, yes, it's been conducted in a civil way. I think it's been a very engaging debate. I think Scotland has become a much more politically aware country since the debate. One of the effects of the debate I think we're seeing today is that the Scottish public seem much more pro-European than is true for the UK as a whole. And part of that reflects the social democratic tradition of Scottish politics. So we don't have UKIP, we don't have a strong conservative, right-wing conservative presence. But I think a second reason is we had a very, very engaged debate about Scotland in the European Union before the 2014 referendum. And even those politicians and individuals who opposed independence said, if we have independence, we have to be in the European Union. So I think we've had a very incredibly constructive debate in Scotland, and I think Scotland's got a lot of self-confidence, political self-confidence from that. I think it certainly benefited the Scottish National Party, who are now seen to defend Scotland's interests within the Union, which is why their popularity rose. If you look south of the border, I think we've seen less effect. Certainly, we've moved towards English votes for English laws. So that has been well received in England because there's been this ongoing concern, why should Scottish members of the House of Commons in Westminster be able to vote, for example, on English education when English members of the UK Parliament cannot vote in education in Scotland because it's devolved. So I think English votes for English laws has been divisive as far as the UK is concerned, but I think it's appeased public opinion in England. Now, I don't think we're anywhere close to a settled view. I don't think we're at a constitutional equilibrium, because I think the Scottish National Party continue to campaign for full independence within a shared sovereignty system, but it would be full independence to allow them to utilise the various levers of economic powers, including foreign policy, for their own benefit. But we've certainly got a much higher degree of self-government in Scotland than we had before ever. So I think it's been a constructive and positive debate, but I don't think we've reached a constitutional balance yet.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Do you? Vamos de tiempo. Bueno, rapidísimamente. En el sistema belga, el consenso es necesario. Pero no hay riesgo de que se bloquee el sistema. ¿Qué pasa cuando no hay consenso? ¿Cómo se solventa? ¿No hay un riesgo de que continuamente se bloquee todo?
Yeah, thank you very much. Then we come back to Belgian surrealism, I would say. Yes, of course, it's been a political decision. The fact that the federal government is at the same level as regions and communities, and that it has implications, for instance, in our external representation, and that you need that consensus. But actually, it's a bit like a prisoner's dilemma. Pretty pretty, after a while, all these governments realize that they actually need one another. Yes, it's a watered-down consensus, but on the majority of the issues, it seems to be possible to develop a Belgian position. Yes, in certain issues in the past, it was about employment and economic affairs, and certainly when it's about money, but it's always about money somehow, it can become quite political, and things are somewhat stalled. But overall, the system seems to be working, because there's a realization that actually these Belgian governments need one another in external representation. So that's actually the lesson taken from that. Of course, actually, our country is quite simple. Six governments, but well, if you're Germany and you have 17 entities, well, that's a bit more difficult, of course. If you would completely apply the Belgian system to that level, I think it wouldn't work anymore. Hence, ladies and gentlemen, the warning, yeah, which I gave in my presentation. A second fact, of course, is that the Belgian model is a bit strange. We claim to be federal, but there are confederal elements already present in the model. The best example in external representation is, for instance, in trade. In trade, officially our federal minister, and now it's a state secretary, claims also foreign trade as a competency, but most of these aspects have been devolved. And now there is a direct agreement between Flanders Investment and Trade, our agency, and AUEX, which is the Walloon export agency, to cooperate directly with one another. So this is already a confederal element, which could be, well, already a glimmer for the future in terms of future development, if you will, of our system. We will see. We will see.
Okay. ¡Qué envidia! Vamos a ajustarnos al tiempo. Me quedan preguntas, pero luego tendremos ocasión de plantearlas. Prefiero ajustarme al tiempo y luego que la gente que vosotros podáis preguntarles. Simplemente dos reflexiones. Una, para que funcionen estos sistemas y para que funcione la negociación y para que funcione el consenso, esos valores democráticos tienen que estar completamente enraizados y tiene que ser una cultura profundamente democrática. Me gustaría, sobre todo como académica, preguntarles, pero ya tendré ocasión, por los sistemas de enseñanza en estos países. ¿Cómo se hace? ¿Qué modelos se siguen para conseguir eso, ¿no? Para conseguir que esos valores sean interiorizados? Probablemente eso empiece desde la más tierna infancia. Y mi interés va por ahí, pero vamos a seguir con lo pactado, nosotros también, y media horita para un café, para un receso. Mil esker, danoi, llevarte.